Living fully alive in every way. You're listening to Relationship Prescriptions with Dr. Carol.
Hello again, friends. It's Dr. Carol, and this is Relationship Prescriptions. I've got a different and kind of fun episode to share with you today. When Al and I first moved to Austin, Texas, about 9 years ago, and started our radio program here at the time, one of the first guests that we had on our program was Lemuel Bradshaw, along with a couple of his friends. Now, you will hear in Lemuel's story some rather amazing things. Lemuel is a heart transplant recipient, and he has now been working in the organ and tissue donation field for many years. April is Donate Life Month. And I thought it would be fun to bring you Lemuel's story and share a bit about this important area. You may think that, why should I even care about tissue and organ donation? But when you hear what kind of life-changing gift this process can give to people, the impact on so many lives, I think you'll be inspired. I met Lemuel in the United Tissue Resources office. You may hear a little office noise in the background. Lemuel's busy at work sharing the message of tissue and organ donation. They are gearing up for Donate Life Month, and so things are very busy there right now. We'll just start this conversation, and you'll hear that Lemuel just launches into sharing his story, and I think this will be interesting and encouraging.
So my story begins in 1998, and I was at the time dating, though I remember it as if we were already married, because we had already become that close in my mind. I guess I already knew I had found my soulmate. And in April of 1998, an engaged couple, me and my fiance at the time, went to Washington, D.C. on a business trip for her. And because she works for a state agency that works with attorneys affiliated with the state bar and then the American Bar Association, which is a national organization, they had different trips and conferences in different cities across the country.
Sure.
I was a happy freeloader every time she went. You know, she went for business, I would tag along, and these trips would be everywhere. Chicago, we went to Scottsdale, Arizona, Denver, Colorado, and this year it happened to be Washington, D.C. I'm also a huge history nerd.
So what better place in Washington?
Exactly. As I was about to say, what better place for a history nerd than to go to D.C. and see all the museums? That was my goal, to see all of them. But growing up as a child, I'd always wanted to go to the Air and Space Museum.
Oh, yes.
And then the natural history portion of the Smithsonian. So it was in the natural history portion of the Smithsonian that I realized that I had some, not knowing what, some problem. Even before we left Austin, I'd had an upper respiratory thing. You know, I couldn't shake the cold and cough and whatever. And airplanes don't make that any better, the air on an airplane. But I was determined that that wasn't going to stop me from having fun on this trip. We get to D.C., I'm trying to force myself through. My wife would go to a conference during the day. I would take off, have breakfast to see the city. And during a visit to the Natural History Museum, I realized in one of the big halls that I couldn't walk from one side of the hall to the other without having to stop and rest.
Wow.
Probably about 15, 20 minutes before I felt well enough to get up and walk some more. And then even that wasn't very far.
And that wasn't normal for you?
Not at all. I was 28 years old. I had always been the biggest and strongest guy in the class all my life. Never really been sick with anything except strep throat in the second grade and chicken pox at 14, which was horrible when you're 14 and all pimply faced.
Tell me about it. I was over 20 when I got it.
And the older you are,
we can go into that. Yes.
Absolutely. So I never thought I was seriously ill. I'd never been seriously ill. I'd been an athlete all my life. Two sports in high school, all state in one, all district in the other. And though I had come to UT and done all the college kid stuff, wasn't very healthy with the pizza and the late night fast food runs and a little beer here and there, I still was fairly healthy, 28-year-old guy. So when I forced myself through this trip and we made it back to Austin, this was now still April, for the rest of the spring and into the summer, my wife, who at the time had 8, 9, and 15-year-old daughters when I met her, and we had commenced the task of raising those daughters.
Wow.
I was working full-time, so was she. We had kids in school, in various stages of school, 3 demanding teenage daughters.
Yes.
Who thinks about or takes time for yourself as a parent.
Right.
And I was pushing myself, but I kept complaining to her about stomach aches that wouldn't go away, then headaches, then stomach aches, then headaches. She finally got tired of me complaining to her and said, "You going to the doctor?" I didn't even have a doctor. I was 28, young, male, and bulletproof and stupid.
And but you generally don't have a doctor when you're like
correct.
That.
Correct. So she sent me to her physician, primary care physician, ear, nose, and throat guy, who every time did the triage, blood pressure. He also, took my heart rate. He said, the first time, "Mr. Bradshaw, I've done a complete exam. I can't find anything wrong with you except the fact that your heart rate is slightly elevated and irregular and your blood pressure is just a little high. But I know you drove here in the middle of the day on Mopac. It's probably traffic. Here are some Buspar anti-anxiety pills."
Oh, my goodness.
"You've told me you just started this new life. It's brand new with all these kids all of a sudden. Take these samples. I won't charge you a thing. And tell me in 2 weeks how you've been." So being from where I'm from in North Louisiana, small country town, I actually grew up outside of the country town where no one addresses issues of mental health. The joke is, where do we not say hello to each other? The liquor store. I didn't see you. You didn't see me. That's the joke up there. What that means is that nobody really goes to therapists or psychiatrists or whatever. Mental health issues are you pull yourself up by the bootstraps.
And you just
and you
deal
move
with
on.
It. Yes.
You row your own boat, man. That's what you do. So that's what I thought I was going to do. And as I'm riding down I-35 or Mopac going back to work, I'm calling my wife and telling her, "This quack you sent me to gave me these old lady pills for people who sit at home and watch Oprah and worry about stuff and eat bonbons." Those exact words to a woman who, at the time, was already over 40. So that's not really the thing you say when you're
the younger person. Exactly. Well, you try and deal with it, but fast forward a few months.
Right.
Things didn't get any better.
Things got worse, and I had gotten to the point where I just couldn't tolerate the stomach aches and the headaches that had gotten bad and progressively worse, and consecutive days of an upset stomach to the point where the only relief that I could find at night was kneeling on the edge of the bed with the edge of the mattress cutting just under my diaphragm to push the fluid down. I didn't know that it was pushing the fluid down. The fluid, as a result of congestive heart failure, was gathering in and around my diaphragm. I was a big guy. Some people show it in their wrists or ankles. You couldn't see it in a 6'3", 250-pound man. So I just got bigger around the gut. But, that could have been an extra few pounds put on with a little extra peach cobbler. And I ended up in the emergency room at Seton after visits several times during the night where they gave me stuff to treat the stomach ache. I ended up going in one day at 8:30 where a young female physician, I always mention my hero's names, Dr. Pamela Cooper, who was 1 year older than me, and her father had exhibited much of the same symptom history in England a year earlier, and he had had a heart problem. So she said, "I think I want to run one more test on you, and I'm going to do a portable ultrasound or have it done, and we'll go from there." And as the technician was giving me the ultrasound, the goop on your stomach.
Oh, yeah, all that cold jelly.
I saw her eyes get really big. And I looked at her and I said, "What's going on?" She set the wand down, pushed a button, ran the tape, tore it off. And as she ran across the room to my doctor, she said, "Oh, nothing. I'm just calibrating the machine."
And you knew it was not that way.
Well, how often do you have people run away from you?
Exactly.
Holding a tape that is about you. So I saw her run up to my doctor, and my doctor looked at the tape. And I could clearly from across the room see my doctor mouth the words, "Who is this?" And the tech pointed across the room at me. My doctor called 2 more docs over. They looked at the tape and I could clearly see them mouth the words, "Who is this?" My doctor pointed at me. The next thing I know, someone is grabbing my gurney and literally, like a medical show on TV, running down the hallway, clearing the elevators. My wife is running behind with her little short legs trying to keep up. We get in the elevator. They take us down to the ICU at Seton, where I am the only conscious patient. My wife and I are sitting in a room full of people who are breathing through respirators. It sounds like 20 Darth Vaders
right.
from Star Wars in
right.
the room. And the beep of the machines is the only other sound we heard. And about what seemed an hour later, my cardiologist walked in. I didn't know he was my cardiologist at the time. And he had three women with him, all wearing white coats. And they sat at the foot of my bed. And he flipped over my chart. And he said, "My name is Dr. David Morris," another hero of mine. And he held up my chest x-ray as he said, "I am a cardiologist here and I've examined your x-ray." And when he held up my chest x-ray, my heart was so enlarged in it that you could not see the bottom portion of my lungs.
Wow.
My heart looked like a chicken from HEB with the legs and the wings cut off in the picture. And I know this for a fact because I have my later heart transplant on tape where they reached into my chest with two hands and lifted my weakened and diseased chicken
out
and put in the new heart, fist-sized organ that it was, in where it's supposed to be. But that's another part of the tale we'll come to later. When he told me that, my first reaction was, "Look, I watch ER every Thursday night." These are my real words. And I know that people like you guys make mistakes. I came in with a stomach ache. This heart transplant stuff is for that guy probably over there who's unconscious, not me. He reassured me that it was me. It took me a while for it to sink in, but I was so angry and in denial that I still didn't want to proceed with the plan that he had laid out. I told him, "Give me medication, I'll work out, I'll shrink my heart back to size, and I'll go on with my life."
But
you know that can't happen.
That didn't really go that way.
Absolutely.
So how long were you there in the ICU?
So after making me sign about a dictionary-sized stack of documents, because they can't make you accept treatment that they want to give you, I spent 3 weeks in the ICU. Not even all in the ICU. Some in the telemetry floor, the regular heart monitoring floor, and they let me go. And they let me go with a pacemaker and a defibrillator implanted and a fanny pack of medications with a catheter pumping dobutamine and Primacor, two drugs meant to help your heart squeeze. And I left 3 weeks later and was set to prove these quack doctors wrong by working out and working myself back into a normal sinus rhythm and a normal-sized heart.
Well, obviously that didn't happen.
For about 6 months, it seemed that I was proving them wrong. I didn't realize I'm just getting used to the medications. They gave me this stuff for a reason. And it seemed for 6 months that I was cheating them and their diagnosis and prognosis for me. And I started to play ball again with the three girls that I'd helped to raise or was helping to raise. We played touch football at Zilker Park. I even played half-court basketball with the boys that lived next door. By about June of 99, however, things started to go downhill as quickly as they appeared to have been on the upswing. And 6 months after that, September or October, I was put back into the hospital for the final time before the heart came that saved my life.
Once you were on the transplant list, and I'm sure there's so many pieces to this story, but once it was clear that your heart was not going to make it and you agreed and were on the transplant list, how long were you waiting for a heart?
I was very lucky, if that's the way you want to look at it, in that I was only on the list 3 weeks. Now, the way that that works is that the sickest gets the first consideration. So I was on the heart transplant list for 3 weeks because I was the closest to death at the time that a heart that matched me became available, meaning that they had told my family and friends the night that I got the transplant, before the heart became available, come and say goodbye to him. He has no more than 48 hours. The heart pump that they had put in to help my weakened and diseased heart beat was starting to fail. Blood was infiltrating back into the lines. My wife had gone home to take a shower and change clothes, leaving me in the hands of my mother and father who were alive at the time, and my friends. I had a large group there watching me around the clock. And she said, she got a call from me as she walked in our house. And I, when she picked up the phone, it was me. And I said, "Baby, they got a heart for me." She jumped back in the car thinking, "I must be hallucinating because he's been unconscious for about 2 weeks. They've had me sedated." She rushes back to Seton, where I'm being prepped and rolled down the hallway. She gets there just in time as they're rolling me down the hallway to surgery to kiss me and tell me she loves me. She said, I looked up at her and said, "What are you so upset about? I'm just having a little surgery. I'll be right back."
A heart transplant, a little surgery.
A little surgery. In my mind, you know, doctor, I think I never really thought I was going to die. Even when I got so bad that my defibrillator had gone off 20, 21 times in a row just before they put me in the hospital for good that last time, I still thought, well, I'll figure it out. I'll get out again and we'll go back to whatever life we had had up until that point. I never really thought I was going to die. Part of that is the ignorance is bliss factor of being 28 years old, 29 by this point. You know, you're young, your friends are all healthy and strong. You haven't really started to see mortality touch
right.
your circle yet.
Exactly.
And therefore, you don't think that it's going to touch you. And it was at that time that all this happened. So definitely, I didn't think I was going to die.
Now, that was in 1999. It is now 2019. You still have the same heart?
I still have the same heart. It has, over the last 19 years, I've done incredible things. I've met my donor family. We remain close to this
day. I wanted to ask you about that.
We remain close to this day, as a matter of fact. They live outside of Houston in Sugar Land, Texas.
What was that like to meet them?
So the first time we met, first thing we did, this was before the internet. Remember, 1999, it was there, but it wasn't in everybody's household.
Right.
We certainly didn't have smartphones.
Right.
I remember we wrote letters, and the first thing you have to do as a recipient is write a letter to, or through, rather, the organ procurement organization that facilitated the transplant, that matched your organ from the donor to you. It has to be an anonymous letter. You can't give hints and clues. All you can express is your gratitude. You give that to them, they give it to the family. The donor family has the right, as I feel personally they should, to decide whether or not they want to take that extra step of meeting you.
Right.
What do you expect of these people? Should anything be expected? They've already given you a second chance at life. Are you going to now force them to look you in the face if they don't want to? So my family made the decision that they wanted to at least know a little bit more about me. They wrote a letter back. I read their letter. We exchanged letters for a while, and I asked, how would you feel about maybe a phone call? And they were open to it. Actually, now that I think about it, I can't remember who suggested the phone call. We've been so close over the years, I don't know who would have been the first to suggest, because it seems like with you, I've just known them forever.
Exactly.
And so anyway, the phone call happened. And I remember they said, we'll call you at 5:30. What time do you get off work? And I said, 5 o'clock. We'll call you at 5:30 at the home number you've given us on a Thursday. Somehow I remember that detail. So my wife and I and all of my daughters gathered around the landline. Yes, it was that long ago. In our living room and just watched the phone waiting for it to ring. And when it finally rang and I picked it up, it was like you opened up the floodgates because we were all crying together.
Oh,
and talking.
Yes.
And that conversation, I introduced them to my family and them to whomever it was that was there from their family at the time. And we talked about making a point of meeting. They invited us to their home outside of Sugar Land. That, as a friend of mine used to say, was an occasion where we were all one big teardrop. We looked at photos. My donor and his widow were childhood sweethearts who met in high school. He was a Vietnam vet, so it kind of gives you an idea
wow.
of how old they were.
Wow.
She even waited for him to come back from Vietnam to get married. They met at a high school in San Angelo, Texas, where from that point on, they were sweethearts. And they had a pictorial history from the early 70s all the way up until the time that he lost his life. I watched this couple grow up together. I watched them raise their children through pictures. I watched their grandchildren and extended family be born. And I shared the few photographs. My wife and I at this time, this was now in 99, had only been married a year. We didn't really have that many pictures yet. So I shared what we had. We talked about our common experiences.
Right.
Turns out He was the father of two daughters. I'm the father of three daughters. We like some of the same exact things. His wife is named Albessa. My wife's name is Odessa.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. It just seemed like we clicked. And
yes.
I even told them how when my heart was sewn in with the last suture, usually they have to shock the heart to get it started. With me, they sewed the last suture in and the heart started beating. And the doctors said it was almost as if that heart was meant for you. And after she visited with us for a while, she said, Lemuel, if I would never want this to happen, but I'm so glad that it was you. Because of that, from that point on, I've tried to live in such a way, knowing I would stay in touch with these people, that they would be proud of the fact that I was the person who received his heart. Because the heart has so much special meaning for some people.
Exactly. Physical, yes, but there's a lot
beyond
of connotations,
yeah.
So much beyond the physical.
That.
A word or two, Lemuel, about what your life is like now. You've had this heart for 19-plus years. I'm sure there are things that you have to do to take care of this heart.
So my daughters are grown now. They're 8, 9, and 15. They're grown daughters now. The best kind of kids to have, the grown and gone kind. Anyway, so now I have 9 grandchildren.
Oh, my goodness.
Only one was born when we met my donor family, barely born at that. And now I have 9. That oldest is 17. The youngest is barely a year. 6 boys and 3 girls. When you ask me what my life is about my 9 grandchildren because they all live in town and there's rarely a time that I don't have a daycare center at my house. So I get a chance to see these folks grow, to be born and grow. I get a chance to work full time, and I do work full time. I was a volunteer even while I was working in other fields on behalf of Donate Life Texas, which is the name under which all of the organizations in Texas work to promote donation, organ, eye, and tissue. And I now work full time for an allograft tissue provider of services, bone, skin, veins, ligaments and tendons, nerves, heart valves, and dermal tissue. All of that too can be donated along with corneas. When a person says yes to the 9-word question, would you like to register as an organ donor?
And Lemuel, I have said yes. Let's move into
wonderful,
that.
Wonderful, wonderful.
You know, I think that your story illustrates just one of an enormous number of life-changing examples that I'm sure we could talk about. You have worked with donor families and organ donation and tissue donation programs and organizations now for quite some years. Let's just talk about that a little bit, because I'm hoping that your story will trigger the desire to make that kind of gift in some of our listeners. Are there enough organs? Is there enough tissue?
First of all, the answer to all of that is a resounding no. As we have this conversation, there are close to, and this number fluctuates above and below, 114,000 people waiting on a national wait list for an organ transplant. Organs only, whole organs. And by that I mean 2 lungs, 2 kidneys, a liver, a heart, a small intestine, and a pancreas. 8 whole organs. In addition to that, which is handled in this area by our colleagues at the Texas Organ Sharing Alliance, or TOSA, there is corneal donation. So 1 cornea per eye can go to 2 different people and restore vision. In addition, the sclera, that membrane, that outer membrane that holds the eye together, you know, it's like a big water balloon, the eye,
right,
can be divided into 4 equal pieces per eye, so that wounds, penetrating wounds or injuries to the eye or disease can also be patched or repaired, or medical research can be done to improve vision. And then there's what we do at United Tissue Resources. As I said before, bones, skin, veins, ligaments, tendons, nerves, heart valves, and dermal, all of that can compound the gift of one person who has said yes to that question, would you like to register as an organ donor? Same registry that they ask if you want your name on at DPS, or if you were to Google Donate Life Texas. It's the same registry. If you do that, those organizations in our area can then facilitate possibly affecting 75 to 100 or even more people just from one person who has said yes.
One yes.
One yes.
Can save and improve the life of 75 to 100 or more people.
Absolutely. I'm so proud to finally have made what was my passion, my job, my daily activity.
Yes.
Now, as a volunteer, I work for United Tissue Resources, a nonprofit organization who in this area, Central Texas, and now even beyond, we're moving into other areas. So that's why we had to change our name. We're no longer the Tissue Center of just Central Texas. We have now expanded and are able to provide this community service beyond just Central Texas. And we, because of it, have been able to help people since 1985.
So they were already in working before you needed a heart.
They were
obviously
a well-established entity. The organization. I'm just happy to be a part of this organization.
Let's address a couple myths that people may have around this area. One is, if a person decides to be an organ donor, does that eliminate the possibility of a funeral if a family should so choose?
Absolutely not. One of the things that we've been trying to get people away from saying or even thinking is using the word harvest. You harvest crops in a field, not the life-saving gifts of organ, eye, and tissue donation. We use the term surgical recovery because people can wrap their minds around what surgery is. Even if you haven't had surgery, you know someone who has.
Right.
And what that means is you know that after the surgery is done, after the incision has been made, whatever is done, you sew that you close that incision. Same thing is done with regard to preparing the body for an open casket funeral. There is no butchery, as has also been used, involved at all in organ, eye, and tissue donation. A person can donate all of their organs, all of the tissues, and the corneas, and still the organizations that facilitate tissue will work with funeral homes to make the preparations so that that person can have an open casket funeral, as is the tradition in their family.
About families and traditions and so on, many of our listeners are people who choose faith, they're Christians. What can you say about the concerns that some of our listeners may have about, does their faith impact the choice that they have in making a decision to be a donor or not?
The Donate Life Texas Registry is both, well, the Donate Life Texas website is both a database and a website of information. The registry is a link off that site. So if you remember these terms, listeners, these words, Donate Life Texas, and you are on the fence about the faith issue or in the open casket funeral issue or whatever, you can go to Donate Life Texas and a page addresses your concerns because there's nothing new under the sun. Same is true of questions.
Right.
As far as issues of faith are concerned, on that page, this is why I referenced it, on that page is the official statement from every major religion in the United States. And every major religion in the United States has affirmed donation as the ultimate form of altruism, of giving. The only two religions with a statement against are Shinto monks and gypsies, and that's clearly stated as well. But every other major religion in the United States has affirmed donation or left it up to the conscience of the individual.
As a gift, and I think that's a picture that I want to really highlight, you received an amazing gift that has allowed you to know your grandchildren, that has allowed them to know you. And what bigger gift for someone to be able to give? What if somebody is not in Texas? What about other states?
So every state or region of the country now has their own Donate Life blank, whatever it is, registry, or nearly every state or every region. So let's say that you are somehow listening to this podcast in Oregon, and you live in Oregon. You can find your state's local registry or region's local registry. If you are a Texan and you're vacationing in Oregon, and God forbid something were to happen to you there, they would identify you, find out where you lived or where you came from, and be able to reference the registry in your state. There is also a national registry. It's called DonateLife.net. It's growing. It's growing. It's not as developed, believe it or not. You know, Texas is, we are on the ball.
Hey,
man. Our registry is only as old as 2005, 2006. Representative Glenda Dawson herself, a recipient, helped to push with others the legislation through that made it possible for us to have a registry. And in 2009, DPS got on board to start asking that question of everyone. But it's made Texas kind of cutting edge, meaning our registry is still new enough, they can reference our registry electronically from the national registry, and not every state can say that. Meaning that it has also allowed us, because we're so cutting edge, and our partnership with DPS does this, to be the second largest state registry in the nation.
Awesome.
1 million people per year on average add their name to that registry. We are growing by leaps and bounds.
So how does somebody say yes to that question?
Several different ways, making it easy. You can either, when you get your driver's license for the first time or you renew your driver's license, you can say yes when that question is asked in person. Would you like to register as an organ donor? And it puts you on the list for everything. Organs, tissue, and eye, all right? And medical research that may advance donation. Let's say that you are involved in a horrible accident that leaves certain organs unable to be transplanted. Perhaps research can be done using those organs to advance the science of donation.
Yes.
Here's an example. Do you realize they can take islet cells from a pancreas, spin them in a centrifuge to create a serum that can help take people off dialysis in some cases?
Wow.
All right. So it's that kind of research that you say yes to when you check that box for research. Or you can remember these three words: Donate Life Texas. I'll say it again. Donate Life Texas. And Google it. Google it on your cell phone, on your home or your laptop, whatever.
Right.
It'll take you to that website, which is there for you to get information, and then a drop-down menu from the top lets you add your name to the registry as well. There's really no excuse for not having those options available to you and at least letting you look over information that might help you make your decision.
Well, Lemuel, thank you for sharing your story. And again, I have said yes to that question. I am registered, and I hope our listeners will thoughtfully consider that as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me, as always.
Well, as I said to Lemuel, I am an organ donor. I have registered on the Donate Life Texas site because I live in Texas. I have done that a few years ago now. Whatever state you are in, I encourage you to prayerfully and thoughtfully consider registering to give this kind of gift. Now, as Christian believers especially, the idea of generosity is a big one. One of the nurses that worked with Lemuel, caring for him at the time he had his heart transplant, used to say this. She used to say, "Don't take your organs to heaven. God knows we need them here on earth." So check that out. Donate Life, whatever your state is, and prayerfully consider registering. I also want to ask you to tell your family. One of the challenges that those caring for people in these kinds of very tragic circumstances often are challenged with is discussing things with the family. Only God knows what will happen in your future. But if you tell your family, that eases the decision both for them and for those caring for you should that time come. I'd love to encourage your questions and thoughts. You can leave me a message at drcarolministries.com/podcast about this episode or any episode. And until next time, may God bless you.